Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast on the state of the science of hexavalent chromium in drinking water. Thank you all for joining us today. I am Alice Fulmer. I'm a senior research manager with the Water Research Foundation. And we are going to hear today from Lori McNeil on the state of the science. However, first I'm going to give you an overview of a recent workshop that the Water Research Foundation held on hexavalent chromium in Southern California, as well as a regulatory update, and then we'll turn things over to Lori. There will be an opportunity for you to ask questions at the end of the webcast. You can type those in and we'll read them and get back to you on air if possible. If there are too many questions, we will respond to those after the webcast. So getting started then, I think you all know hexavalent chromium has been in the news for quite some time now, going back to the Aaron Brockovich movie and prior. But more recently, the driver for the workshop that the Water Research Foundation held was the activities in California related to the public health goal there, as well as an environmental working group report that came out with various concentrations of chromium-6 in different raw waters and drinking water sources. So the workshop that we held had two objectives. It was to assemble industry experts to exchange state-of-the-science information about hexavalent chromium, or chrome-6, with drinking water utilities and regulatory agencies. And it was also to identify additional information and research needed by water utilities and regulators to inform regulation and then to comply with regulation if, in fact, it is made here in the future. Again, the workshop was held in Southern California. It was on August 18th and 19th. We had 220 participants either in person or attend remotely by webcast on the 18th. There were several presentations made. We covered the regulatory perspectives both from the California Department of Public Health and the US EPA. Also had the results of health effect studies presented by the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment and Tox Strategies. Had a few folks present on analytical methods for detection and occurrence data. Also talked about known treatment options from the utility perspective and the consultant perspective, and some estimated costs with regard to treatment. Lastly, we finished up with some public communication strategies for hexavalent chromium and discussion of research needs. I'll give some brief overviews again, some highlights from the presenters at the workshop, starting with Eric Burnson with the Office of Groundwater and Drinking Water, who presented on the federal regulatory status. Currently, as many of you may know, there is only a regulation for total chromium, which is chromium-3 or trivalent chromium and hexavalent chromium. That MCL is 100 parts per billion. It was promulgated in 1991, and compliance is measured at the entry points to distribution systems. Recently, last year, March 2010, with the six-year review, round two, the EPA concluded that revision to the standard was not appropriate until the health assessment is completed, this being the Integrated Risk Information System risk assessment. So currently, the EPA is working with others to update that IRIS risk assessment. Other information that they would need for regulatory determination under the Safe Drinking Water Act is health effects, occurrence, treatment technologies, and analytical methods. So a little bit more about health effects. Again, the IRIS risk assessment or draft IRIS toxicological review for hexavalent chromium was released in September of 2010 based on review of peer-reviewed published literature. Then in May 2011, they had an external peer review panel meet, and they posted that review in July 2011. some of the comments made by that external peer review were that they should wait for an ongoing tox strategy study, that it is very important for low-dose extrapolation for Chrome-6 or hexavalent chromium. Also that there seemed to be consensus that there is non-linearity at the low doses of hexavalent chromium in water. And there was disagreement about the mode of action, whether it was mutagenic or whether it just promoted a cellular response that at high doses led to such cellular damage that a mutagenic effect was observed. So those comments are being reviewed by the EPA and incorporated into the assessment, after which EPA will determine if new drinking water standards need to be established for hexavalent chromium. Now, a little bit more information about the regulatory status with regard to occurrence. Right now, neither hexavalent chromium nor total chromium are proposed on the list of 30 contaminants for the third unregulated contaminant monitoring rule, or UCMR3. EPA has requested public comment on this, and they expect the UCMR3 to be promulgated early next year, 2012. If it is included, or if they are included on UCMR3, monitoring will be scheduled for 2013 to 2016. In the interim, EPA has issued voluntary guidance to water systems on monitoring for hexavalent chromium, in addition to their required monitoring for total chromium. This guidance is located at the link provided here on the screen. And the guidance includes recommendations for sampling locations, those being entry points to the distribution system, in the distribution system, and intakes and wells. It also includes guidance on sampling frequency, which is recommended as quarterly for surface waters and semi-annually for groundwaters on the same day in all those locations mentioned previously. And lastly, they recommend use of this modified version of EPA method 218.6. Moving on now to the regulatory status in California, which is quite different, as many of you may know. California is on a much faster track, and again, they were the driver for this workshop. We had Dave Mazera with the California Department of Public Health present this information. The total chromium MCL in California is a little bit lower than EPA at half. It's 50 ppb. And they have indicated their intent to regulate hexavalent chromium in drinking water. In July of 2011, California's Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment, or OEHA, published a final public health goal for hexavalent chromium of 0.02 parts per billion. And, of course, this was caused for concern. It was lower than the previous draft public health goal and is lower than a lot of the previous studies had been looking at removing hexavalent chromium. Currently, California is conducting or has conducted many of the pre-MCL activities needed for regulation. These include collection of water quality data to define the extent to which the contaminant of concern occurs within California. The majority of this data was collected back in 2001 to 2002. Then some of the ongoing activities are there supporting studies or projects evaluating treatment technologies, some of this using Prop 50 money. They're also gathering information on the cost of these treatment technologies, collaborating and evaluating advances in analytical techniques available for reliable detection, and coordinating with public and private stakeholders on all of these activities. Their next steps include phase two, which is draft regulatory package development. This is where the department performs an extensive cost-benefit analysis at various trial MCLs, considering the occurrence data, treatment feasibility and cost, costs of monitoring, analysis, and contaminant removal and disposal, and potential population exposed or affected. Following that will be phase three, which is the formal regulatory adoption process. And all of this could take about 3 to 4 years. They do plan to release a draft MCL within 18 to 24 months of the public health goal that was released at the end of July, and then it will be approximately 12 to 14 months to complete the formal rulemaking process. Following the regulatory perspectives at the workshop, we had two presenters on health effects. First, George Alexis with OEHA, and he presented on many studies that influenced their public health goal determination, but most importantly, the National Toxicology Program, or NTP, study that concluded a couple of years ago that there was clear evidence of carcinogenic activity. And again, this was used as the basis for the California public health goal, but it is currently being questioned by the IRIS External Peer Review Panel and some others. Following that presentation, Deborah Proctor with Tox Strategies presented on some ongoing work that they have investigating the mode of action of hexavalent chromium and data gaps that were identified within the NTP study. The work that they have done to date does show nonlinearity at low doses, which would impact that extrapolation and the goal to which we need to treat. And the papers that they have published are available publicly online at the two links provided here in the website, or excuse me, in the webcast. The next presenters at the workshop talked about analytical methods, occurrence, and treatment, and we are lucky enough to have one of those available today, Lori McNeil with Utah State University. Other presenters included Andy Eaton with MWH Labs and Chad Seidel with Jacobs Engineering. I'm not going to go into much detail about their presentations because Lori is going to cover these topics later in the webcast. Next, we had treatment presented by Peter Kavanaugh with Glendale Water and Power, followed by Nicole Blute with Malcolm Perney Arcadis, and she talked not only about the treatment options, but also about the cost, and I will go in to a little bit of detail on that in the next slide. The main treatment options for hexavalent chromium are reduction followed by coagulation and filtration, otherwise known as RCF, as well as ion exchange, both weak base and strong base anion exchange, and reverse osmosis. Like I said, I'll talk a little bit about cost. And I should note that it's important when you're talking about cost to focus both on total chromium removal and hexavalent chromium, because this does impact both the effectiveness and the cost of treatment technologies. And this is because, as you may know, chromium-3 or trivalent chromium can convert to hexavalent chromium and vice versa. Therefore, with a lot of these treatment studies that these costs were developed on, we're targeting 95% removal of total chromium and removal of hexavalent chromium to less than 5 parts per billion. So there is a bit of a difference between the treatment goal there and the public health goal that California has now finalized. So with those in mind, treatment costs developed to date are expected to range from $360 per acre foot to $720 per acre foot for the weak base anion exchange process, and $130 per acre foot to $430 per acre foot for the RCF process within the ranges considered to date. So those costs could be quite exorbitant, as you can see. Cost curve development is underway for multiple MCLs with multiple influent hexavalent chromium concentrations and multiple system sizes. So there should be more information coming, but there is still a lot of work left to do. Both the California Department of Public Health and US EPA need this cost information for regulatory consideration. Next, I'm going to talk about risk communication, but first I'm going to ask you all to respond to a poll question that we've created. You can bear with me a moment. Okay, so the poll question is, has your utility communicated with your customers about hexavalent chromium, and if so, how? Options are, we have not communicated with customers about hexavalent chromium specifically. Yes, we have via one-on-one individual customer inquiries, or yes, through organized research. Now, you will need to, after we see the results here, which I'll discuss in a minute, I do want to remind you that you will have to close out the poll results in order to see the next slide. Okay. So, most of you submitted A. You have not communicated with your customers about hexavalent chromium at 62.5%, or excuse me, now it's been updated, 50%. 16 or 17% of you have communicated with your customers through inquiries that you've received from them, and 33% have actually conducted organized outreach to your utilities. So that's great. I know we have been getting some inquiries, so it's not surprising that you have as well. Now, we do have some resources for risk communication, and Matthew Corson with American Water New Jersey and Don Ortega both presented on the risk communication strategies at the workshop. First, it's very important to be first, if possible, be right, and be credible. You want to gather the facts, quote the experts where possible, and be clear, especially with regard to units. Consistency is very important. And to avoid technical jargon, all of that helps your message be as clear as possible. You want to consider how to best communicate with different audiences. One example of a good communication soundbite presented at the workshop was that we are on top of it. We are sampling for hexavalent chromium. We're working with the US EPA and the water industry to further investigate the issue and determine appropriate next steps. The Water Research Foundation also has other resources available to help with risk communication. These are listed here. A project published in 2004 called Risk Communication for Emerging Contaminants. A newer one published just last year, Contaminant Risk Management Communication Strategy and Tools. And lastly, an ongoing project that we expect to be completed shortly, Water Utility Framework for Responding to Emerging Contaminant Issues. There are also a couple of projects more focused on endocrine disrupting compounds and pharmaceuticals and personal care products that provide some information that could be used for any emerging contaminant as well, and those are available on our website. The last presenter of the day at the workshop was Steve Via with the American Water Works Association, and he presented on research needs remaining for hexavalent chromium. The research needs he presented were further vetted and prioritized by experts in a scenario planning exercise we held August 19th following the larger workshop, as well as some follow-up conference calls. We used this information to develop a research roadmap. And I'll present that in the next slide. Some of the research identified as being important and needed are treatment performance under different water quality conditions, and again, coming back to that cost component, which is very important. The fate of hexavalent chromium from the source to the tap, including distribution system, treatment chemicals, etc., and tools and assistance to further help utilities communicate with the public about hexavalent chromium. Here's a graphical depiction of the research roadmap we created, and I must apologize that the slide got a little corrupted in the uploading here, so if you can imagine the road going more through the center there. There are still some remaining needs with regard to health effects, the analytical detection, though we have a project addressing that that Lori will talk about. If you're talking low-level occurrence, there's still some need for that at the national level. In the distribution system, It's important to look at how disinfection impacts the transition between hexavalent and trivalent chromium, as well as any contribution from corrosion. And then, as I mentioned, treatment being very important. We want to do multiple case studies at different utilities, look at chromium through treatment and distribution, look at how it might be contributed by treatment chemicals, look at the residuals that are created and how we might handle those, and evaluate novel treatment options as well, and as I mentioned, the communication strategies. So with that, I am going to just talk a little bit about where you can find some additional information. Here's a list of ongoing water RF research, as well as the state of the science that's going to be posted on the waterrf.org website. And if you would like the full presentations made at the workshop, they are available at this link below, the Water RF CR6 info link. All of the presenters' presentations are there, as well as some other great links. So thank you all for your attention. I'm now going to turn things over to Lori McNeil, who's going to talk further about the state of the science. And after her presentation, we will have a Q&A session.
All right. Hello, everybody. This is Lori McNeil at Utah State University. Thank you all for joining us for the webcast today. What I'd like to talk to you about is a summary of a state of the science review that we have done as part of the Research Foundation Project 4404. As Alice mentioned, there is an extensive written literature review that will be available on the Water RF webpage. It's got all of the references for the material that I will be presenting here. So this presentation is a summary of what we have covered in this literature review. The outline of what we'd like to talk about today is first to reiterate some chemistry about chromium, then look at occurrence of chromium-6, look at a little bit more about health effects to build on what Alice talked about earlier. We will talk about analytics for chromium, a little bit more about treatment, and then summarize some of the knowledge gaps. Just a very basic review of chemistry, and I know a lot of you may already be up on this, but to make sure that we are all on the same page. So the two principal forms of chromium that we are concerned about in drinking water systems would be chromium-3 or chromium-6. And those do convert. Chrome-3 can be oxidized to chrome-6, chrome-6 reduced to chrome-3. Chromium-6 is the species everyone is excited about. You will also hear it called hexavalent chromium, chrome-plus-6, or chromium-6. I'm going to use the Roman numeral notation throughout this presentation, as you see in the title of this slide, chrome-6-VI. It is the oxidized form of chromium. In water, the aqueous species of it are anionic chromate species. The pKa there is around 6.5. Chrome-6 will sorb or co-precipitate with iron as well. To show this in a little bit of a cartoon form there, then in the middle we see those soluble, the aqueous forms, the two anions. That can be in equilibrium with chromium that is sorbed to the surface of a particle, for example, iron hydroxide. Chrome-6 can also be what we call fixed. It can be incorporated into a precipitate. For example, if we have chromium and iron aqueous form at the same time that then co-precipitate, that chromium is within the precipitated structure. Chromium-3, then, trivalent chromium, is the reduced form of the species. In aqueous form, there are numerous forms, most of them cationic, depending on the pH. Chrome-3, like with chrome-6, will sorb or co-precipitate with iron. Chromium-3 also forms its own precipitate, chrome hydroxide, with a minimum solubility of about 1 microgram per liter at pH 8. And chrome-6 will complex with organic matter. So again, to look at the little cartoon representative of this chemistry, in the middle, those soluble forms of chrome-3. But now, there are several other ways that the chrome could be distributed. As with chrome-6, it can be sorbed to iron hydroxide, or it could be fixed within the precipitate, co-precipitated. It could also precipitate itself as chrome hydroxide in the little blue cloud down there. Or chrome-3 could be complex with natural organic matter in a soluble complex. Just to reiterate the importance of iron in this situation, what this graph shows us is using the diffuse layer model, looking at if we have 2 milligrams per liter of iron in solution, and we have either 5 micrograms per liter of chrome-3 or of chrome-6, how does that chromium react, absorb to the surface of the iron? So what the graph is showing, on the y-axis we have the amount of chromium that is soluble. So that's a percentage. On the x-axis, we have pH. The typical range is shaded in the gray there, say between pH 5 and 9. So looking first at the blue line, that's chrome 3. Over the range of normal pH that we see in drinking water, chrome 3 is expected to be not soluble because it would be sorbed to iron. In contrast, chrome 6, which is shown in the red line, the amount that's soluble will depend on the pH. At higher pH, say above about pH 7, then the chrome 6 will be soluble. Below pH 7, less of the chrome 6 is soluble because it is sorbed to the iron. So that was our brief chemistry review. I do see that there are a couple of chemistry questions. We will try to get to those at the end in the Q&A session. I'd like to move on now to talk a little bit more about occurrence of chromium. Overall, chromium is the 21st most abundant element in the Earth's crust. It can get into water by either natural weathering of chromium-containing minerals or by anthropogenic sources. There is widespread low-level occurrence of chromium. There are several studies, and again, if you want the references for these are in the written literature review that will be available on the webpage. Studies have shown that rivers in the U.S. average between 0.5 to 1.4 micrograms per liter of total chromium. Groundwater is around 1 microgram per liter. We have done a study here in our lab looking at bottled water, and we tested a range of bottled waters and found up to 1.3 micrograms per liter of chrome 6. Several other research studies have shown that chrome 6 can be present in black tea and herbal tea at concentrations of up to 17.5 micrograms per liter. And there's another study that found that total chromium is quite prevalent in soft drinks. So what we'd like to do before we move into more chromium occurrence is to have a poll of the audience. Alice mentioned that EPA has issued some voluntary guidance for utilities to monitor, and we're just curious if you have done any monitoring for chrome 6, and if you have, what concentrations you have seen. So that poll is out. Please go ahead and respond, and we'll look at the results in several slides from now. We tend to think that chromium occurs because of anthropogenic sources, contamination. However, it's important to point out that there are a number of naturally occurring reports of chrome 6. So in California, they have found up to 100 micrograms per liter. In Mexico, a study found up to 12. And down in Brazil, up to 220 micrograms per liter. This is naturally occurring. It's not because of an anthropogenic input. This is assumed to happen because of weathering of chrome-3 containing minerals and then oxidation of that chrome-3 to chrome-6. This would typically be in a groundwater, and you would think that if there's no dissolved oxygen, the oxidation could not happen. That is not the case, though. Even in the absence of dissolved oxygen, manganese oxides can mediate that oxidation reaction, and we end up with chrome-6 in the groundwater. Coming back to drinking water then, there have been some studies that have looked at the total chromium in drinking water. Way back in 1962, the USGS did a study. There have been a study in Canada, several studies here in the U.S., and the numbers vary a little, but overall it does point to low-level chromium occurring in drinking water in the low part per billion, microgram per liter range. And as Alice mentioned, the bottom point there is the six-year review that EPA just did. They have those results as well. Looking specifically at chrome-6 in drinking water, there are fewer results from that. California has the largest database. They've been monitoring quite extensively for chrome-6, and this is raw water sources, not treated water. And approximately one-third of all the sources do have chromium greater than 1 microgram per liter, and about 5% have seen chromium greater than 10 micrograms per liter. A Water Research Foundation-funded project in 2004, the NCBOS, National Chrome Boron Occurrence Survey, looked at raw waters across the U.S., found an average chrome-6 concentration of 1.1 micrograms per liter. And then, of course, the famous or infamous EWG report looking at tap waters with a range of non-detect to 12 micrograms per liter. The issue is that we still do not know the full extent of occurrence. And even with the data sets that I just referred to, the analytical capabilities vary quite widely, especially in terms of detection limits. So it's difficult to compare results. Now we are looking at very low levels with the public health goal that was established in California, whereas some of those previous studies did not even quantify down that low. There is a new Water Research Foundation-funded project, 4414, that will be looking at these occurrence data, trying to draw some trends, looking at spatial and temporal analysis. And this is a fast-track project, and so you can look for the results of those in several months here. And if you bear with me just a second, we're going to look at the results of the audience poll here in terms of concentration. And it looks like so far 38% of the respondents have not done any monitoring. We've got 10% who monitored and found below detection limit. Another 38% detectable but less than 1 microgram per liter. 11% between 1 and 5 micrograms per liter. And 3.4% who are greater than 5 micrograms per liter. So those results would seem to be fairly consistent with the results that we're seeing so far. But I do appreciate you showing that. And remember, you do need to close that window in order to see the next slide here. All right, moving on then, we'd like to talk just a little bit about health effects of chromium. Expand a little on what Alice mentioned at the beginning. Chrome-3 is an essential nutrient. You may have it in your multivitamins. Chrome-6 is classified as a human carcinogen via inhalation. So lung cancer rates have definitely been linked to chromium-6. However, when you ingest chromium, for example, in drinking water. The chrome 6 can be reduced to chrome 3. So back in 1998, EPA in IRIS said that carcinogenity of chrome 6 by the oral route, so by ingestion, right now cannot be determined. There's not enough data. And they also said that the non-carcinogenic effects were non-reported. However, as Alice mentioned, there have been recent studies reevaluating this. The NTP program in 2008 did a study about cancer in rats and mice. They did find what they said was clear evidence of carcinogenic activities in the rats and mice at the elevated doses of chromium. When we look at the human occurrence, there is limited data. There is controversy about this data. And so it is unclear if chrome 6 is a human carcinogen based on the epidemiological data. EPA is reviewing this data. As Alice mentioned, in September of 2010, they released this review. Currently, that document is still under review and out for comment. When they have that final report, it will help them do two things. First of all, define what are the non-cancer and cancerous health effects, and then develop a dose response assessment for oral exposure, that is consumption of chrome 6. That will then guide EPA in terms of setting a new MCL, if they will do that. Moving on then to analytics. There are a lot of acronyms on these next couple of slides, and I apologize in advance for that. Again, this is a brief overview. If you want to look at that written summary, it does have all of these defined as well as all of the references. What I'd just like to focus on now is looking first at total chromium. So that would be chrome 3 and chrome 6. There are a number of methods that are currently approved for monitoring total chromium under the Safe Drinking Water Act. Those are our ICP methods, ICP-ES or MS, so emission and mass spectrometry, graphite furnace, that's GFAA, and AA atomic absorption. The important number there is highlighted in the red, the MDL, the method detection limit. It's an indication of how low of a concentration can be detected by these methods. All of those are in the low part per billion, microgram per liter range. And so to remind you, our total chromium MCL is 100 micrograms per liter. These methods then can very comfortably analyze low enough to meet this MCL. However, when considering the California public health goal of 0.02 micrograms per liter, none of these total chromium methods can go low enough to tell you if you are at that public health goal level. A couple of issues associated with total chromium analysis. Preservation calls for the samples to be preserved to less than 2 and has no filtration. That means also no digestion if the turbidity of the sample is less than 1 NTU. One issue associated with that is if we don't digest, we may not recover fixed or sorbed chromium, again showing in the little cartoon there to remind you what that is. Another issue is ICP mass spec is a very common method used. However, there is a polyatomic interference from argon and carbon, has a mass of 52, which is the same as chromium. Many people use CCT, collision cell technology, to overcome this interference. However, CCT is not approved by EPA for the mass spec method. There are some people doing studies looking at digesting samples to see if it solves this interference and if it can help us recover our fixed and our sorbed chrome. That's ongoing work. Chromium 6 analysis is an ion chromatography, OIC, method. You adjust the pH to 9 to 9.5. That puts the chromium into the dichromate form, which is an anion. So that anion is separated from the water using an anion exchange column. You then add that diphenylcarbazide reagent. It forms a pink-colored complex with the chromium and detects that chromium with the spectrophotometer. The main challenge with this is that we only want to measure chrome 6. We don't want to measure any chrome 3. The method is selective. That's good. However, we don't want to oxidize any of the existing chrome 3 because then it will be quantified as chrome 6. So there are a number of requirements with this method to use preservatives in order to maintain the speciation, and that's where there is some ongoing work. Again, an alphabet soup here, but just the top row there, MDL, MRL, LC-MRL, acronyms, I apologize, but just think of them as various ways to talk about how low can we quantify chrome 6. The important thing to point out, again, if we're trying to reach that California public health goal level of 0.02 micrograms per liter, we do need these newer methods of this IC method in order to achieve that low of a detection limit. EPA is working on an update to their accepted method, 218.6. Their draft method is called 218.7. It is still in preparation, but it can comfortably reach those low levels of 0.02 micrograms per liter. A couple other notes on speciation. Many people have done work using HPLC or IC in combination with ICP-MS. What this allows you to do is analyze both chrome 3 and chrome 6 in the same sample. Because right now, what you need to do is measure total chrome on one instrument, chrome 6 on a separate instrument, and then subtract to get chrome 3. This methodology allows you to detect both in the same sample. There are a number of parameters that need to be optimized. They're listed there. And also, again, to point out, if you're using mass spec, many people will use that collision cell technology, CCT, in order to eliminate the polyatomic interference. However, that is still not approved for monitoring in drinking water. One other analytical item of interest, the USGS has recently developed a field method for chrome 6 speciation. They use a cation exchange column to remove the chrome 3 out in the field when you collect the sample, and then measure the remaining water, which is assumed to be all chrome 6, with a graphite furnace. There are some limitations to this, and this is actually part of what we are looking at in this project. Moving on to treatment, then, for the chromium, we need to revisit this idea of the redox chemistry between chrome 3 and chrome 6, because this will be the basis for many of our treatment strategies. So, oxidizing chrome 3 to chrome 6, we've divided this into two sets of reactions, looking at what we'd call fast and slower reactions. Fast reactions are those mediated by either manganese oxide solids or chlorine peroxide or permanganate. Slower oxidation can be achieved with oxygen and chloramine. Looking at the other side of the redox couple, reducing chrome 6 to chrome 3, we can do that with a quick reaction using ferrous iron, Fe plus 2, stannous chloride or sulfites. Much slower reactions happen in the absence of dissolved oxygen when we have sulfides and many bacteria. We also then need to consider conversion of soluble forms, dissolved forms of chromium, to particulate chromium. Chrome 3 will precipitate anytime roughly above 1 microgram per liter. That's the solubility of that chrome hydroxide solid. That typically happens when the pH is above 5. And as we discussed earlier, both chrome 3 and chrome 6 may be converted to particulate forms when we add a coagulant, particularly iron, although possibly also alum coagulant, either by sorption of those species to the flock or co-precipitation as those solids are being formed. When we look then at where we might control Chrome 6, we really have three choices: looking at the source water, at our treatment, either our existing treatment or new treatment that we would add, and then we need to consider what happens in the distribution system and for premise plumbing, all of those affecting the chromium before it gets to our customer's tap. Some considerations then for each of those. In the source water, we are concerned with how much Chrome 3 and Chrome 6 do we have. Well, of course, we may be able to just look at source selection and try to choose a source that has less chromium. Another option is the potential in-situ reduction of Chrome 6. This is not a technique that has been used in the context of drinking water, but it is used for remediation of hazardous waste sites that are contaminated with Chrome 6, where you can inject something like ferrous iron into the subsurface and reduce the Chrome 6 precipitated out. Again, the chemistry is there, but it hasn't really been tested for drinking water. In our treatment plant then, and Alice mentioned some of these treatment steps, we've got our reduction coagulation filtration step. We also have got membranes, ion exchange, and reductive resorptive media. Two things to consider, though, during treatment. The first is that we may be inadvertently adding chromium either from our treatment chemicals or from our infrastructure. There is data being generated right now where we are seeing chromium as a trace contaminant in chemicals, especially ferric chloride coagulants and lime. We also may have chromium leaching from infrastructure, such as stainless steel components. When that happens, then, if it's Chrome 3, it could be oxidized to Chrome 6. Similarly, then, out in the distribution system or in the premise plumbing of the household, we need to be concerned, is chromium leaching from that plumbing when that plumbing is corroded? Are we oxidizing Chrome 3? Could we be reducing Chrome 6? If we have an iron pipe that's corroding, producing ferrous iron, we may be actually reducing the Chrome 6. And then at the end, do we instead look at a point of use treatment at the household level? Those are all questions for where we might do our treatment. These are a few more concerns or considerations. So moving back to our source water, again, that in-situ removal, that has been done in hazardous waste sites with much higher levels of chromium, but there are a few studies for that looking at potable water. There are some concerns of the remaining iron or reduced sulfur that might be there and the cost of doing that. Chrome 6 certainly can be reduced. We know that works with iron or stannous chloride. The level of understanding is pretty high, but we have to be concerned about residuals of those compounds. And then looking at the treatment, the reduction, sedimentation, coagulation, and filtration, we have a fairly high understanding of that chemistry. The concern is the cost of that if we need to implement that as a new kind of treatment. Some of our other treatment techniques, membranes, we know that membranes will separate out Chrome 6. However, we have the concerns of cost and what to do with the reject water. Ion exchange, there has been a lot of good data generated down in Glendale looking at ion exchange, weak base and strong base. We're getting a lot better understanding of what's going on there. Zorption is another opportunity using zorptive media. There's not been a whole lot of large-scale demonstration of that. We did see generally poor selectivity for some of those media. Point of use treatment is generally well understood, be it an ion exchange or a reverse osmosis system that we would install at the point of use at the customer's tap. The concerns there would be maintenance and affordability. Going back to our issues, though, are we forming Chrome 6 in our system? That could happen first if we've got chrome 3 and it gets oxidized when we add a disinfectant or a treatment chemical. This is really important to understand because if we only focus on removing chrome 6, but we still have chrome 3, we may be oxidizing that chrome 3 and creating more chrome 6. We also need much more information on chrome 6 leaching from our infrastructure. As I mentioned before, stainless steel. Chrome 6 is also a component of some cements and cast iron. And so as those infrastructure components corrode or degrade, we may be releasing chrome 6. There's also a note that we may be forming chrome 6 in water heaters from chrome 3. There are a couple of studies that have shown that higher temperature favors the oxidation of chrome 3 to chrome 6, and so that may be another potential path of exposure. And as I mentioned previously, we may have the good news of reducing chrome 6 in our distribution system, either by bacteria or ferrous iron that comes from corrosion. There's not a whole lot of data out there, but this could potentially be a good thing for us. We would need to be careful that we're not remobilizing any of those particles that form. Briefly then, this is part of this current project. We are collecting chromium profiles in treatment plants and distribution systems, collecting samples where you see here the red stars, before and after key treatment steps so that we can see how is chromium changing throughout the system, both the treatment plant and out in the distribution system. This is an ongoing project, and we'll be asking for volunteers in just a minute, so if this is something you are interested in, you will have an opportunity to register that. Finally, to conclude, looking briefly at the knowledge gaps, and this reiterates what Alice presented as her last slide. The first unknown, of course, is the health effects. What will be the conclusion of those health effects studies? We need more information on low-level occurrence of total chromium and chrome 6 in drinking water. The analytical methods, the method for chrome 6 is fairly well developed. It's still a draft, that 218.7, but where we really need the work is on total chrome. Total chrome methods are not as sensitive as chrome 6, and that presents a challenge for monitoring total chromium. We need to quantify how much might we be adding chromium into our process, either through our infrastructure or our treatment chemicals. We need to do much more work on the treatment methods in order to meet a potentially new low MCL, and of course update the cost estimates for that. We need to really be aware that any trivalent chromium, chrome 3, could be oxidized to chrome 6. And again, we need to have clear and effective communication strategies for our utilities. Our third question then for the audience is, are you interested in participating in research? There is a lot of ongoing research right now, and rather than showing you the results here, this is just an opportunity. If you want us to record your interest, please vote yes here. If you don't want to vote yes right now, that's fine. If you are interested later, you can contact Alice, and she can get you connected with the various research projects. I need to say a few thank yous then for this project. First to Alice, who you've heard her name multiple times. She is the project manager for this project. Our PAC, Project Advisory Committee, Andy Eaton, Chad Seidel, and Chuck Hertz. Terry Freeman at the Foundation was our technical person who got this webcast going for us. And also a number of graduate students and undergraduate students in our lab who are busily working away on this project. So with that, we will go to the question and answer session, and I will turn that back over to Alice.
Well, thank you very much, Lori. Great presentation. I hope everyone enjoyed it. We have gotten a number of questions, and since we most recently talked about treatment, I'll ask a couple related to treatment first. We have a question. Is there any removal potential from biological GAC filters?
Oh, That's a good question. Biological GAC filters. I don't know off the top of my head. I know that GAC has, in general, a pretty low capacity for chromium removal, but I don't, that's a great question, and I don't have a good answer for that. I can do some searching and see if there have been some papers about that. There are certainly some bacteria that can mediate that reduction. So that's a great question. I don't have an answer for that.
That's all right, Lori. I think that Carollo may have done some work on this, so hopefully that's a question we can get answered when we post this webcast on our website later. All right. Is it possible if you replace your iron pipes that you might inadvertently be causing an increase in chromium-6?
I'm not sure if the questioner means if you're replacing your iron pipes with something else other than iron. I guess the concern could be that if you had old corroded iron pipes, there may be chrome-6 or chrome 3 that was built up in the scale, and any disturbance of that scale could release those particles into the water. A second thing could be if you had been reducing chrome 6 by forming ferrous iron because of corrosion of pipes, and then you no longer have corroding pipes, then I suppose that is possible. You're basically no longer removing the chromium. So I hope I understood that question completely.
I think so, but again, if the person who asked the question doesn't feel it was answered sufficiently, you can resubmit, and we'll try and answer that after the webcast. So here's one for you, and I think you may have answered it later in the webcast, but just to be clear, does chlorine oxidize chrome 3 to chrome 6?
Yes. Chlorine will oxidize chrome 3 to chrome 6. The time of that depends on how much chromium and how much chlorine, but we would consider that to happen in hours, certainly within a day. And so within the distribution system, that is a very likely possibility.
Thank you. Okay, do we know enough to make a general statement about the relationship, if any, between high iron manganese at a groundwater well and the level of chrome 6 at the well?
That is another great question. I do not know, but there was a previous project the Research Foundation did, the National Chrome Boron Occurrence Survey, and they looked at co-occurrence of various other constituents and chromium. I don't have that information right at my fingertips, but that is something that we can look up and see if they did see any correlation between iron and manganese and chromium.
Okay, thank you. Okay, here's a question more about the chemistry. Is non-complex chrome 3 more difficult to oxidize to chrome 6?
That is a great question. I don't know if that has been studied. My guess is it could interfere with that oxidation. Another great question. I don't know, though, but let me do some research into that.
Well, that's understandable. This is a large topic. So we have time for another couple questions, and then all of the others we'll need to try and answer after the webcast. Can you remind us, please, on the equilibria between chromate and dichromate and the solubility, complexation, et cetera, of dichromate?
Let's see. So if the person is asking, so the chromium 6 in aqueous form, it typically exists as an anion, either the negative 1 or negative 2 charge species, and the pKa, so the point at which that switches over, is at about pH 6.5. So below that it would be the monovalent anion, above that the divalent anion. And then solubility and complexation, there are not any significant Chromium-6 precipitates that form in drinking water, and it does not complex to a great extent with NOM.
Thank you, Lori. All right. I think we have a couple of other questions that it looks like were asked earlier in the webcast that I think were answered near the end. So I'll skip those and go to, is there a potential removal efficiency using pretreatment aeration?
It would depend on what your removal strategy is. Dissolved oxygen will oxidize Chromium-3 to Chromium-6, although that is a very slow reaction. And so my guess is in a typical residence time of aeration pretreatment for a treatment plant, you will not see significant oxidation of Chromium-3 to Chromium-6.
Okay, thank you. All right. With that, we're going to need to wrap up. We do have a number of questions that have come in right at the end here, and I apologize that we don't have the time to answer those right now. But we will get those posted, as I said before. So thank you all for your attention today, and thank you, Lori, for a great presentation. I would like to remind the audience that we'll have a couple of poll questions at the end about your webcast experience. Please, we would really appreciate it if you would take the time to answer those before you sign off today. And I hope you'll join us again for our future webcasts. Thank you very much, and you all have a great day.